particular than 2 years ago.
Here this morning, and we'll be joined by another at least 1,500 people tomorrow, if not more. So I'm going to leave the key message to our speakers and to a little bit later in the opening. I'm just going to do some very quick housekeeping items. With that, I'm going to turn you over to the fabulous Tyler Downey, who is from SEIU.
SEIU in the house.
Make sure that if, both the provincial and the federal government are aware of our intentions with the accord, that we want more investment into universal health care. We want to make sure that universal health care is there for future generations.
Right.
We definitely oppose the Conservative Party's view on public health care. It's been a staple in our society, in this country, and we want to ensure that it continues for future generations. For SEIU, we have 60 activists here.
Oh, okay, that's what I'm after.
Yeah, we're about...
So in other words, quite...
That's right.
Because numbers tell the story usually.
That's right, that's right. Most of our members here are from the Niagara and from the Hamilton area.
Yeah, of course, so they won't have to travel so far.
That's right, But we are even in the GTA all across Ontario, very active on this front.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
With that, I'm going to turn you over to the fabulous Tyler Downey, who is from SEIU.
SEIU in the house. Welcome, everyone. My name is Tyler Downey, and I'm the director of the Member Leadership in Action program at SEIU Healthcare. I mean, we're here for many different reasons, and before I introduce some of our speakers today, I just wanted to share some thoughts around why I believe we're here. And it's something I told my group this morning at breakfast. This is like the moment of clarity for us, right? We came to this moment and we're here in Niagara-on-the-Lake. And what's clear to me, and what should be clear to you, is that Stephen Harper doesn't give a shit about us.
That's right.
Stephen Harper doesn't give a shit about Canadians, really. When you think about some of the things that he's talking about changing,
quite the opposite.
Some of the damaging effects that his health report could have on our society for generations to come. It's clear to me that this government feels like they just do whatever they want to do, right? So I believe that we have a moment here together to unite our voice and do what we need to do and walk away with a real action plan to do more. So hopefully folks take that back with them wherever you travel to and just realize that this is the moment that we can either change or be part of the change that Stephen Harper has in store for us.
In this room and the energy we're going to have tomorrow, and it's an honor to be on this panel with these fabulous warriors for public health care, and I'm just delighted to be here. Stephen Harper is a dangerous ideologue. I think we need to understand what we're dealing with here. I actually don't think he likes his job. I haven't seen him look happy in a very long time. He was sent by whatever force sent him into our world to do a job, and he is doing it not with pleasure. I think he can hardly wait for it to be finished. But his job, his marching orders, were to change Canada as we know it, and he is doing it. Deep and terrible environmental cuts, and all of the horrible things about Lac Megantic, one of them is that that was one of the lakes that was delisted from protection from fossil fuel pipeline and trains going through. They delisted 99% of the lakes and rivers in Canada from protection. He's waged a war on science and scientists. Unless you're making money for the corporations, there's no money for science in this country. He set up an enemies list, and I just want to say that anybody who wants to get on it, you're welcome to join the Council of Canadians. He set up the deepest corporate tax cuts in the history of our country. Of course, there's no money for everything we need because he's given it all those corporate friends. a denial of health care to refugees that they don't tend to like, more enemies, I guess. And as Michael said, a comprehensive economic and treaty agreement, trade agreement with the European Union that is going to give the big drug companies all the money and all the power that they have been seeking forever. And now he's got his sights set on our public health care system. This is a prime minister that has opposed public health care and public health care financing for many years before he was prime minister. He used to be head of the National Citizens Coalition, which came into being to fight public health care. Colin Brown, the founder, used to say that public health care funding would kill Canadians. He said so many, many times, but he didn't have the courage to run on killing Medicare because, of course, as Michael just said, and as we know from other polls, Canadians deeply value our Medicare system. So he's doing it through the back door, through the removal of federal funding, which will lead to a patchwork of services and, of course, privatization. And I have a warning that I think we need to learn from the water issue, and that is that what they've done is they've said for water infrastructure for any community that wants new infrastructure or to expand, if they're going to get federal funding, they have to go to a P3 model, public-private partnership model. And so we're fighting this in St. John, New Brunswick, and Regina, Saskatchewan, and a number of other communities where the councillors don't want to go private, but the only way they can get any federal money is if they go private. And I see this as the next step coming for healthcare. Healthcare is a reflection of our shared values in this country. It comes from the many, many years of sacrifice and commitment by other generations of Canadians. I think of the treatment that my mother has received, and she's 90, almost 93 now, and has had the most extraordinary health care in the last few years when she has needed it. Never a question, never a bill, never a crossword, never a thought that maybe you're not of the generation or an age where it would matter to us to take this kind of care for you. Unbelievable. And it reminds me as well of a few years ago visiting friends in the state of Maine and witnessing an accident on the highway. A car hit a little boy about 12 years old, was on his bicycle. He was quite badly hurt. He didn't die, but he was quite badly hurt. We stopped. The car went on. It was a hit and run. Some people stopped as well. They called the ambulance. The ambulance was made up of volunteers, and so it took them forever to get there. When they got there, they said, we have to find the child's parents because we can't take them to hospital unless we can prove that the family has insurance. So I stayed with the child. Andrew went to find the child's parents. We found the child's parents who came back frantic. In the end, the child was fine, but it might not have been that way. And I see these images of these two systems. To me, it's just absolutely stark. The choice here is stark. It is here now. One day, Stephen Harper is not going to be Prime Minister of this country. We will have left great damage in his wake, but the loss of our public health care system will not be one of them, and this is our pledge here today. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Campaign 2000 is a nonpartisan national public education movement to build awareness and support for the 1989 all-party House of Commons resolution to end child poverty by the year 2000. It began in 91 out of concern about the lack of government progress in addressing child poverty, and we're still at it because today 4.2 million people in Canada live in poverty. This means that overall, 1 in 8 people in this country are living in poverty, and it's troubling that poverty is even worse among marginalized groups, including women, immigrants, racialized people, people with disabilities, and Indigenous people. Child poverty rates among some of these groups are as high as 1 in 2 children.
Since 1995,
Michael
has 25 years' experience working in coalitions on issues related to Medicare, privatization, food and drug safety, and economic justice. He's the author of Ill Health Canada, Putting Food and Drug Company Profits Ahead of Safety, published by the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives in 2005. Michael studied political science and theology in Ottawa, and at the Institut Catholique de Paris, he was senior researcher from 1982 to 1990 on issues of economic justice with the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops. From 1990 to 1993, Michael was the national coordinator of the Action Canada Network, where he campaigned to expose the threats of society, democracy, and the environment posed by the North American Free Trade Agreement. Round of applause for Michael.
Thank you very much, Tyler. I agree with you, this is a moment of clarity. I want to bring with you greetings from Shirley Douglas, who tweeted this last night. I'm very grateful for all the guardians of Medicare gathering in Niagara-on-the-Lake to stand up for Medicare and to fight for a new health accord. So welcome, fellow guardians, and believe you me, National Medicare needs guardians, because what stands between Medicare and its destruction are the peoples of Canada. And so that's why we're here. I want to just say a couple words about the threat. We are facing, we all know this, a prime minister who does not believe in Medicare. He constantly says that healthcare is exclusively a provincial jurisdiction. And we know this is wrong. And the good news is Canadians are not buying this ideological rant of the prime minister. Close to 90% of Canadians think there's a strong federal role in healthcare. We just put out a poll today that said 8 in 10 Canadians want the Prime Minister to call a First Minister's meeting to plan the future of Medicare. So nobody's buying his view. The people of Canada are strongly supportive of federal leadership in healthcare.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for being here on such a beautiful day. And thank the previous speakers, who I think have given very trenchant and thoughtful context of the challenge that faces us, both in terms of its urgency and potentially your role in moving it forward. Canadian Doctors for Medicare is an organization of physicians and friends across the country who become increasingly concerned about trends towards privatization within Medicare and the impact that that would have. I won't go over the ground that's already been eloquently covered, but I'd like to focus a little bit on a couple of things and a couple of the ways in which society and sadly many of my colleagues are trying to wedge into our solidarity, wedge into our collective commitment that's represented by Medicare. Now, one of the ways that they are doing this, of course, is a very obvious one. Those who are self-interested, who see profit in moving things forward. And their general strategy is the Chicken Little strategy. The sky is falling, people are getting older, the diseases are getting more complex, it's going to all fall apart unless we get a bunch of private money into here. Hence the P3 at the institutional level and at the front end level, where they're quieting a lot of reasonably well-off Canadians by saying, well, you shouldn't have to leave your mind behind. If you can afford a slightly better car than your neighbor, why can't you afford slightly better health care? So there's that kind of fear-mongering that kind of creates these things. My response to them is that they underestimate the resilience of Canadians. I just want you to think about what this room accomplished in the last hour. I sort of saw a whole bunch of people in purple shirts coming in. We had to accommodate to that, and I identified with them. I was actually, as far as I can know, conceived on VJ Day. That is the end. I am the baby boomer. I am what you fear. I am what your prime minister says that requires us to go private. But what did we do? Did we segregate them all at one end? No. They're spread around here. And what did they do? What are they bringing to this? More voices, more ideas, more experience. And think about it. We need innovation, and that's the fundamental direction that Canadian Doctors for Medicare is taking. We need innovation in the present system.
I'm going to focus on the economics of the issue, and I'm really well positioned to do that because I'm not an economist. And I'm going to start with the conclusion. The conclusion is we've been fed the wrong questions about Medicare and our public health system. Over and over again, we've been led by Fraser Institute and ably abetted by mainstream journalists. We've been fed the notion that somehow or other this is not a sustainable, affordable system. That the rate of growth and expenditures in healthcare exceeds the rate of growth of the economy. With an aging population, and even as I speak, I'm aging, with an aging population, demands on the healthcare system are going to go crazy. We can't afford it. That's what we've been fed over and over again. Well, it's the wrong question. The wrong question. Let me give you the conclusion to my talk, then we'll have the talk. The conclusion to my talk is we can't afford not to have public health care. It is. Absolutely sustainable. And the real question is, how do we and our political leaders work together at all levels of government to stop the erosion and to make it better? That's the real question. That's the only question. And that's the only question we should commit from our political leadership.
Whoever wants to read it can read the thing, you see?
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
nice. Where are you? What are you doing?
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I forget what it was.
Yeah, it's
For a couple of days?
Yeah, yeah, 2 days, yeah. A couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. And the previews were down the road.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember the odd thing.
And I can read it at home, and like I say, mm-hmm. I'll put it on YouTube. Great. Oh, awesome.
An hour.
What democracy looks like!